Our text today is the gospel reading. There were also women looking on from afar off. They followed Jesus from their homeland far to the north, down all the dusty roads and over all the miles to this terrible and inhospitable place outside of Jerusalem. Mary, the woman who came from Magdala, Mary, the mother of James and Joses, Salome, the mother who once wanted her sons to be at Jesus' right hand and left, and you wonder if she still wanted her boys at Jesus' left hand and right. And Joanna, and Susanna, and others whose names we do not know. Jesus had not called them away as he had the 12 apostles. And they might have remained in Galilee, as did many others. But they loved him and believed in him and followed him, and they ministered unto him the best they could. And they didn't quit when others did that Friday morning as Jesus was led away to that hill called Golgotha, the place of the skull. And they stayed there through all the long hours that followed, as he hung suspended, tormented, and taunted, and his gallant enterprise apparently gone down in defeat, and they couldn't do a thing about it any more than a mother can stop a war that calls away her son, or stop a disease that has her child in its grip. And they remained there till at last the beloved Nazarene bowed his head with the words, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit," and then was gone. We Americans, in every crisis, like to say, "Well, don't just stand there for heaven's sakes. Do something." But there are times when there is nothing that we can do, and we have to stand there helplessly as these women did. There are evils we cannot control, and injustices we cannot correct, and things that are too broken to be fixed. And sometimes the best thing and the only thing we can do is admit our inability to do anything at all and simply look to our Lord with breaking hearts. Illness is such a time, and convalescence. People who have been through it will tell you the hardest thing in the world is to do nothing at all. And that's especially true for people who have been busy and productive and active in all their life. And when you're sick, and I mean really sick, down and out, and the simplest endeavor, getting out of bed, going to the bathroom and back again, become major undertakings, then you're not surprised to know that the word patience comes from the word patio, suffering. And when the Bible calls you to patience, it is calling you to long suffering. That means that you simply got to let go and lean back on the love of your family and friends, on the capacity of your doctors and nurses, and look to the mercy and power of the great physician to help you. Patience is also required, and suffering, for every person who takes care of the sick, the disabled, the handicapped, the aged, and the infirm. You don't sit at a bedside very long before you realize how mentally and emotionally and physically exhausting it is. And especially when you know it isn't going to get any better. Or take it of a relationship that is disintegrating before your very eyes, in spite of every attempt of yours to restore it. Or some child of yours sauntering jauntily down the road to sure disaster, and there's not a thing you can do anymore to stop it. The great law of Moses allowed for specific cases that are beyond human solution. That's a rebuke to your thinking and mine. We believe that we can understand everything, know everything, explain everything, control everything. And no, we can't. Sometimes all you can do is entrust the issue to the keeping of God and believe that He will sort things out and do the right and just thing. Jehoshaphat was not the sharpest tool in the shed, and his blundering into trouble must have been maddening for his people. But he was aware of his shortcoming. And he spoke one of the great prayers in all of the Bible. Oh Lord, we do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon Thee. God must have loved that open, honest admission. For He turned the wasteland of that man's life into a veritable garden. Helplessness is not at all the end for God. There is truth to that ancient proverb. Man's extremity is God's opportunity. God can work with our failure if we only give Him half a chance to do it. Our helpless, looking to the God, is not helplessness at all. He has promised you, they that wait upon the Lord. Now, don't wait on the doctor, the calendar, job opportunity. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and never faint. When Jesus finally bowed His head, the women were pleased that He was at rest. At least no more indignities would be heaped upon Him. But they were wrong. The Jews, the leaders, did not want the sight of a triple crucifixion desecrating their holy day. So they demanded that Pontius Pilate put the criminals out of their misery and get rid of the bodies. Soldiers came and smashed the legs of the man to Jesus' right. Then the legs of the man, hastening their death, but not sparing them any pain, When they came to the king of the Jews, they saw that he was already dead. But just to make sure, one of them reared back with a javelin and hurled it into his limp body. Blood and water seeped out of the wound. But now what would happen to the body? Well, the Roman way was to leave him hanging there as prey for the loathsome birds and as a warning to all passers-by. The Jewish leaders didn't care what happened to his body, whether it was flung into some rogue ditch or tossed into Gehenna, the disposal grounds of the great city. And just then, out of nowhere, a man steps out of the shadows whom you've never met before in this narrative. His name is Joseph. He hails from Arimathea. The Gospels give you only a thumbnail sketch of the man. He was honorable and a man of some capabilities because he had amassed a small fortune. The people had honored Joseph by electing him to the Jewish council, the Sanhedrin, the highest ruling body of the nation. Joseph was waiting for the kingdom of God to come. He saw it coming, or he thought he did. The dawning of a new day in this Jesus. And if Jesus were not the one, well, there would never be another one. Somewhere along the line, Joseph became a disciple of Jesus. That's the good news. The bad news is, he was a secret disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews. Well, he had much to fear. The hierarchy promised to excommunicate anybody who professed Christ openly. And that meant more than the loss of religious privileges. It was political, social, economic blackballing, and even the denial of a burial. Joseph had his reputation to think about, his financial holdings to protect, and his own personal well-being to consider. And Joseph went against his timid nature. Joseph declares publicly his friendship to Jesus. And he does it when Simon Peter has denied him and the 12 have deserted him and Christ has been condemned as a false prophet and a public enemy. Joseph goes right in and asks permission to take the body of Jesus from the man who that very day had condemned Jesus to death. And he could only wonder what ugly reprisals the Jews would come up with against him. Joseph hurried back to Calvary in a race against the clock. See, at sundown, the great Jewish Sabbath began. And our work had to come to a stop according to Hebrew law. Others helped him as he lowered the cross to the ground, removed the nails from hands and feet, bathed the body hastily of its bloody gore, and wrapped it round and round in white linen. And now where? Well, in a cemetery garden, not far away, Joseph had his own family tomb. It was hewn out of the rock. And into that grave they carried the corpse, laid it in a niche in the nearby wall, put the headpiece in place, and then rolled a large stone over the door. And then Joseph like the women, had done all that they could do. And so Joseph joins a line that was forming up that Friday morning, a line that will run on and on unendingly. First, there was Simon of Cyrene, who shouldered the cross and helped Christ carry it. Then there was the thief on the cross who said, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And then there was the centurion at the foot of the cross who said, "Truly this man was the Son of God." And then there were the women standing there watching. And now Joseph joins the procession. And did you notice? They all came hopelessly, without recognition and without reward. They came in the dark when it was too late. They didn't come to Jesus to get something. You know the way people come to church today and the way churches advertise they should come. Come and get something. Get peace of mind. Get a handle on your life. Get the key to personal success. Jesus always said it was the other way around. You get a life only by giving it, by spending it and sacrificing. Whosoever loses his life for my sake is the only one who's ever going to find it. Joseph could not have known. The women didn't dream of what God would make of their devotion, too little and too late. But they had witnessed a splendid act of self-sacrifice. And they responded to it in a way that no commandment could ever make you do. And that's what St. Paul means when he says, "The love of Christ constraineth us. He died for all, so that we who live no longer live for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again." Amen.